Welcome to Politics of Code. Today we will focus on the aspect of the public. We want to look at public and private, not so much from the perspective of privacy or surveillance and control, because we have a dedicated lecture on that in 2 weeks from now. So today we want to look at the public in the sense of that there is people in the public. Well, I mean, public has quite changed its meaning, I would say, since the rise of social media, since everyone can now post themselves and become a public personality. This has, of course, on the one hand to do with vanity, as clearly you see me here showing off how important I am. On the other hand, of course, it is a very important way of reaching out to people and telling, I'm here, where are you? And by that, forming a public. I want to first deconstruct the word public. So public comes from the Latin populus, which means the masses. The Romans or the ancients didn't have really a concept of ethnicity. It was not yet fully understood that there is these cultural forms of ethnicity. Of course, people knew that there is a bunch of people who speak the same language, and that was seen as rather defining. And also it's debatable in how far people like 2,000, 2,500 years ago would actually have a concept of race. You find concepts like that definitely in very early writing. In particular, it's laid down in early Vedic writing, as far as I know, and so on. So there is this understanding of people who are together, a mass. The Romans didn't find that very flattering. The people were always low. You didn't want to belong to them. The same is for the Greek, holoi popoi, all the people, always is derogatory. It means everyone who is of no ranks. That changed in the 19th century. So in the 18th and 19th century, people become aware of human beings, so to say. That's a long history of what is called humanism in Europe that starts around 1500 with several philosophers seeing human beings as genuinely the same. It takes a while until that forms in political thought. I mean, it's called the Enlightenment, the era that starts about 1720 after the War of Spanish Succession, and then leads to the age of revolutions, starting with the revolutions in the US in the formation of the first anti-colonial revolution in America. And then shortly after that followed in France. So we are 1776, 1789, then in Haiti, where in particular the enslaved population rises up, Brazil, Mexico. So during the turn to the 19th century, so around 250 to 200 years ago, people start to unite and rise against their oppressors. That is called revolution. Turning something around. So, and for revolution, you have the concept of the public. The revolution is always mobilizing the masses in a positive sense. So you can't have a revolution without appreciating those who start fighting with you. So this is totally different if you are just a gang of ruffians stealing other people's money. I mean, of course, you don't care what other people think about you. But if you have the concept of taking power, of changing society, you better get the support of many people behind you. And so during that time, the idea of the people changes from being something negative to being something positive. American philosopher John Dewey, one of the great philosophers in education theory and pragmatism, in the early 20th century, I think around 1925 or so, first defined the public as a group of people who face a similar problem. So people who recognize a problem organize themselves to address it. At about the same time, a bit earlier in Germany, Ferdinand Tönnies, one of the founders of sociology, saw this as one of the great changes from just being people in one village, for example, fighting for survival, to organizing across what would become a nation, which requires a totally different way of thinking. I mean, you can't assume that people who are like hours of travel from apart from each other, or even days apart from each other, actually face the same things. So with the public comes
Almost
immediately also another aspect, which is publicity. So publicity means that the public has a means of communication, that there is, for example, newspapers, that there is mass media. Publicity means addressing the masses, and this is exactly what you need to form a general opinion across one country. And this is how the concept of the public is inherently connected to modern times media. So media in the 19th and 20th century play a crucial role in facilitating what is the public. And of course, another aspect of public and publishing is publicity is public relations. So if you have public media, a public address, you have people who professionally care to form opinions, and these are public relation people. Public relations for many people has a very negative meaning, and I understand it to some extent. I have to disclaim that over a long time of my life, I worked in that field. I made extensive use of public relations myself, and in particular, in one part of public relations, I earn most of my money, and that is in advertising. Advertising is a way of addressing the public to sell things. I mean, that's the genuine way of advertising. And in many languages, for example, in Italian, where advertising is pubblicità or publicité in French, it is synonymously with the public. We will at a later time look a bit more how advertising has its specifics in our interactive media world. So if you look at my Instagram photo here, I mean, clearly I intended that to be seen. The account is not locked. Everyone can look at my things. So I am aware that I am in public here. Well, this is a totally different form of publication. This is a diary that I found lying on the street in Brooklyn a few years back. And
Very good.
disturbing to see that, I mean, in a heap of trash. So clearly someone's house was emptied. Probably the person had moved away or was dead. The diary is from the mid-1990s, so 1996 is one of the pages here. So at that point, that was already more than 10 years back. And also the handwriting and language would tell that the person who writes here probably at the time was already in her 30s or so. And I didn't really know what to do with it. I mean, I avoided actually looking at it, but I couldn't help in picking it up to discard it, to remove it from the public, to see the incredibly private things that this woman would write here, addressing a lover who was not present.
And
talking about very intimate physical things. So I was very touched and I thought I actually have no right to see this. So I only looked at this one page and I closed it and I thoroughly destroyed it so that no one else would ever abuse it. But I couldn't help making this one picture to keep in mind what it means when your very private suddenly is turned to the public.
In all
times, like when I was young, that was never so much a problem. It hardly ever happened. I mean, the worst that could happen is that someone finds your diary, and that is then one person, and maybe they shared it with someone else. But with the internet, that has totally changed. I mean, I can make photos of the pages of this diary and just put it on my Instagram account. Everyone can read it. So I can, without any effort, turn this very private thing that I stumbled upon into something published. And the American scholar and researcher Dana Boyd, who founded the Research Institute Data and Society in New York, I became aware of her work when she, at that time, she was a researcher at Microsoft, and she gave a totally interesting and revolutionizing talk, the transcript of which you find in the literature. Basically, she says, because we have the internet and social media doesn't mean that people don't care about their private lives anymore.
It's totally the
same how you feel embarrassed of being brought in public light if you don't want that. How easy that slips away has totally changed. So people always knew that they could step outside and be in public, be seen by other people. And usually you would dress differently. I mean, at home, you might wear a bathrobe, for example, but on the streets, you wear a suit or a dress. So people know how to act in public. I mean, as you saw in my Instagram picture, me wearing a neat dress shirt and not a t-shirt, and posing, kind of being cool and not emotional or whatever. I mean, whatever mask you put on, whatever behavior people find appropriate. The distortion with interactive media, with online media, you might share your thoughts
with other people,
sending them direct messages on with some kind of messaging service, for example, Twitter direct messages, Instagram direct messages, and someone might just publish that, or someone might just accidentally open the service's API and every data comes to light. Someone might just forward an email that was totally meant to be personal to a greater group of people. So, and then there is, of course, services like WikiLeaks who actually ask people to send in private information to make them public. So it has changed what private and public means. So, and what Dana Boyd says, even if something
is
publicly visible,
it doesn't mean
that everyone is supposed to look at it.
It might be
that something that becomes public was not meant to be published. And that is one of the core tensions of our digital age between our private sphere and the public.
Cool.
The public, I mean, what does it mean to act public? We have heard about Hannah Arendt's concept of being political means to take action. And that is actually very closely connected with the public, as we saw in John Dewey's definition, the public of being a group of people taking action to solve a problem that they share. So very famous here in Hyde Park in London, at the northeast corner of Hyde Park near Marble Arch, the Speaker's Corner. So the Speaker's Corner is no special place in the sense that, there is no special law or anything like that. It is just for the last 200 years, a tradition has formed that people come to the Speaker's Corner to speak up and gather crowds around them. If you ever come to London and go there, there's always people speaking. Usually it's total nutheads. I mean, like with totally weird religious fanatism or so, or telling absurd conspiracy theories. But once in a while, that's not the case. Once in a while, I mean, people actually have a cause and incite riots and get the masses moved. For example, in 1855, when the Parliament in London suspended the British trade on Sundays, so that people were no longer allowed to do any kind of business on Sundays, which means no grocery shopping on Sundays, which in previous centuries didn't matter so much because most people lived on a farm anyway. But in the 19th century, everyone was suddenly employed, and the employees had a six days work week, and Sunday was the only day where they could actually shop. And so that was something that people were very dissatisfied with. And so giving a talk, a person addressing that was obviously so convincing that starting here from Speaker's Corner, a major uprising started, and that changed the law. And by the way, one of the people in the crowd who witnessed that was Karl Marx. Karl Marx had in 1849, after the failed revolution in Germany, gone to exile to Great Britain to join his friend Friedrich Engels, who was a very successful businessman in England and who was supporting Marx. And Marx saw this moment of these riots as one of the moments where he hoped that a European revolution would start, that has unfortunately not taken place. So, and that went on, for example, in 1972, after the horrible massacre that British troops committed in Northern Ireland, the so-called Bloody Sunday, three members of the IRA, of the Irish Republican Army, gave a speech at Speaker's Corners. People were very moved by that speech. And the three were immediately arrested for sedition. No charges in the end, I think, were pressed, but they were held captive for several months. So it's not gone, although it has become much less a thing, in particular since we have social media. So this was last year, mid 2020, at the peak of the virus pandemic. A great public movement rocked through all of the US and Europe, which was Black Lives Matter. So Black Lives Matter in the US, of course, was a very focused social cause to end discrimination and police brutality against non-white people. But here in England, it has a different turn. This is Brighton in South England at the seaside. A huge crowd gathered, and the British were particularly also demonstrating against this colonial culture that they would still see, that many of their more conservative countrymen and women would still believe that the British imperialism was a good thing, and would still have all these bronze statues of slaveholders and the most horrible imperialists standing around. And so the protest in England was very much focusing also on bringing awareness to your own history. And there was quite some public going on, and you see clearly what a public space is. So this is a totally legal protest. People in England have the right to protest. You get a license for your protest at the city hall, and then the police has to protect your protest. That's the same in all other European countries, that people have a constitutional right to protest, to gather and articulate their voices. So this is the final moment of the protest, people gathering around a small stage where Black Lives activists would address discriminatory practices in the British administration, talk about discrimination against migrants, and so on. So a very strong protest, and definitely people managed to get a huge awareness of other people in the country for their cause. So here we have a park that is a public space. Public space, as Hyde Park and this park, doesn't mean that everything is allowed. Very strict rules, sorry, what you can do in public, but you have constitutional rights, what you are entitled to do, and that is in particular being politically active.
The opposite.
These are various signs in London that tell you that even if you think that you are just walking on the Thames embankment, which looks perfectly like a public space, that you must not forget that it is a privately owned space and you are here only by permission that the landlord of this private space might withdraw any time. So this is another aspect of reality. These are private spaces that are frequented by the public. We will look into that in a minute. Yeah, and then, of course, it's these spaces that are really private, that are so private that there is armed force to keep you out, as this sign says, not only in English, in Chinese, in Thai, and also in Malay. So you might guess that it is in Singapore. I took this picture. Singapore is very strict. People behave there very orderly or get in trouble. And that is, I think, shown here, even for people who are illiterate, it's very easy to understand this sign. So this is the opposite of a public space. This is a very private space. It is by admission only. Only people who have special rights granted can enter this space. Is this privatization of the public. I tried to make this picture. It's in the Victoria and Albert Museum in London. It's the so-called Sackler wing. So the Sackler family is kind of insidiously famous for using their drug money to buy public spaces. So what they do is, Victoria and Albert Museum, a huge amounts of money, and then they get their name on a whole wing of the museum. If you don't have as much money, it is a bit more ridiculous. This is, I mean, as much you can afford to put your name on a room. So this is a weird thing. If you have a public institution, like a publicly owned museum that belongs to the people, and a private person puts his or her name, it's usually his, mostly men who are obviously so vain that they can't wait to die before someone names something after them. Something interesting happening in the 19th century that is in between. So this is a club or saloon. A salon is a privately owned place where people gather. So this is a typical political club here in Brooklyn. It is dedicated to people from the same ethnic ancestry, obviously, and it of course invites people of the same political leaning. In particular, it is obviously also meant for women, to encourage the inclusion of women into politics. I mean, clearly that is a very old institution. So the salon is something different than a public space. I mean, clearly this is a privately owned building or a privately owned shop, but it is also not private in the sense that no one can enter. It's very inviting in a way even, and you enter and you are invited to share your opinions. And this is how the salon started. In Italy, in around 1600, so maybe 450 years ago, in Europe, the first salons were formed by people who knew that they couldn't talk badly about the ruling house in public. So they couldn't just sit outside and tell that they didn't like their duke or whoever was in power. So they would invite other people to talk about these things in private. I mean, also, of course, political discussions, then in particular in France, that concerns enlightenment. So discussions about humanism, about democracy, forming a republic, that would be strictly prohibited and censored in the public, were allowed in these private salons. So, and that is something that is kind of in between the public and the private, is the salon, what the German philosopher Habermas calls Öffentlichkeit, the public sphere. So we have the public, which is the street, or what we publish on social media. Then we have the private, which is our home, where we are in charge, hopefully at least. That could also be a letter that we send to someone, and we have usually, in most countries, protected privacy for sending a letter. And then we have this place in between, which is could be a cafe, it could be any kind of space where people share their thoughts but are not bothered by the authorities. And in the mid to late 19th century, that is particularly the so-called arcades. Arcades or passages are these structures that look a bit like railroad stations, first formed in France and then quickly spread around the world. They have a roof, so you can gather even in bad weather and talk and sit, and but still be protected, because it is actually not a public space in the sense that the king or the government has any special rights here. And if we go to a mall in the Emirates, we find that the shopping mall in the Emirates has a very similar function. You see here in Yas Mall, people gathering in exactly that way, sharing the space, being protected from the weather, and having the chance of exchanging with each other. For me, it is very interesting, and I have to say that I, of course, can't claim any special knowledge about the Gulf region, having myself arrived here just so recently. But here, going, for example, to Al Ain, and seeing the Majlis, the council of the late Sheikh Zayed, immediately brought to mind that also is a form of this public sphere. It is not outside, it's not that everyone joins, it is people sharing gawa and the date, and having a conversation to form opinions. And in particular, I find it very, very interesting how the concept of the majlis then transforms into the first majlis of Abu Dhabi that you can visit at the Qasr al-Hosn in downtown Abu Dhabi, where in 1972 the United Arab Emirates were formed. So we have now walked through all these aspects of the private and the public in space that is not yet very technological. The idea that that we have a public space or this kind of public sphere is also often connected to publishing. So this poster, Brooklyn Library, where I took the picture, that is a quote allegedly by Erasmus of Rotterdam, the famous Dutch philosopher and theologian. So Erasmus, in conversation with other scholars in his time, in particular in scholars of the both sides of the church. I mean, the church were just was splitting in two parts, in the Protestant part and the Catholic part. He had conversations, he had exchanged letters with many people of different opinions. And in one of these letters, indeed, Erasmus formulates the idea that the library is a space where you can escape. So, this is from a letter that Erasmus wrote to his friend John Fisher. John Fisher or Johannes Rofensis was a clergyman in England who was in opposition to Henry VIII around 1530. So, and in 1532, Henry VIII threw John Fisher into prison together with many other people because Henry VIII was splitting the English church from the Catholic church. And people with this kind of universal idea of Catholicism, of keeping the church together, like Fisher, were in his way. So Fisher, shortly before he was then executed by Henry VIII in 1534, and literally like weeks before that, had a letter exchange with Erasmus. And Erasmus writes to him kind of as a consolation, and I do not fail to consider how assiduous you are in the library, which for you is the paradise that you have found. So obviously Fisher had still access to books, and Erasmus says, at least that, and this is your paradise. This very famous quote also by Borges in his poem of the gifts. He says that talking about libraries, and it says, me who used to figure paradise in such a library's guise. So the idea of the library as being a special place where you can escape to has a lot to do with the public, because what you find in the library is published books, is books where other people put their minds into. And this is another idea of having this sphere in which you have things at hand that can console you from the otherwise unfavorable fate that you might face. So this I find also a really stunning work of art. I vaguely remember that as a child, even having seen pictures of it. So the Argentine artist Marta Minujín creates this totally amazing temple, like the Parthenon, the biggest temple in Athens, from 30,000 books that were banned under the brutal military dictatorship of General Onganía. that lasted from 1976 to his demise in 1983. So all these books, I mean, there is, of course, the books that every dictator bans immediately, like Marx or Gramsci or Sigmund Freud. But there were also books, I mean, that I find really interesting that they were banned, like Adam Smith, Hemingway was banned, Borges was banned, Hegel was banned, and even The Petit Prince, a children's book, was banned in Argentina. So she builds this beautiful temple and invites then the public to take the books home and reappropriate what they were denied under the dictatorship.
So finally,
we move forward to publishing as the form of the public that most people, I think, associate with the word. So the public in the 19th century is in particular the newspaper. So the newspaper starts to become a thing in the early 19th century. It's closely connected with another invention that is the steam engine that would rotate the printing presses that would newspapers in significant circulations, but also the steam-driven railroad that would distribute a newspaper nationwide. And if you come to London, I'm a bit England heavy here, my talk these days, but I mean, the UK was very early in these developing a public and the publishing also. Go to the city of London, south of St. Paul's Cathedral, you find Fleet Street. And Fleet Street is where the newspaper publishing industry in the 19th century starts. And on the, in the pavement, you find these commemorative stone slabs that tell you the story. For example, here in Hind Court, the Daily Express. So that is Hammersworth, was then ennobled Viscount of Northcliffe, who starts the Daily Mail and the Daily Mirror, which is the first popular journalism newspapers. That is newspapers that explicitly avoid complicated language, that explicitly address very popular topics. I mean, like very low topics, actually, and that are usually, I mean, like right-wing and leaning towards kind of unsavory conservatism. So Northcliffe, around 1900, owned about 40% of the British newspapers, and was by that means basically in control of the public opinion. It's a bit like Rupert Murdoch, the Australian newspaper publisher, who particularly supported by the Conservative Prime Minister Margaret Thatcher in the 1980s, also created this opinion monopoly in the UK. So Northcliffe is also, of course, related to inciting the public for the First World War, and has done other horrible things. I mean, I mentioned in the last lecture this quote by Paul Sethe, that the freedom of the press is only the freedom of 200 rich people. And I think Northcliffe is really one great example of that. Close by, you find lodgings. This is where Charles Dickens had his publication. So Charles Dickens, in a way, you could say, is the other side of being a popular writer. So Charles Dickens, in his magazine All the Year Round, there was a magazine that would have stories about small people's lives, what we call Dickensian stories, about poor people and their struggles, but also about people who are not that poor, but I mean still small and powerless, like small lawyers, shopkeepers, police people, and whoever. So this is what Dickens was writing about here. So the famous stories that were published here is, for example, A Tale of Two Cities, Great Expectations, but also Dickens' collaborator Wilkie Collins, famous for The Woman in White, or Edward Bulwer Lytton, or Elizabeth Gaskell were publishing in the All Year Round magazine. Now we can ask ourselves, I mean, since I talked so much about the public space, brick and mortar, or in the newspaper or in books, is public space always offline? This question here in a very public work of art asked by the South African Australian artist Greta Loew in her installation in 2019 in Munich, I think is a very reasonable question to ask. Is public space always offline? And when the internet became a thing in the late 1980s, and in particular, of course, after the invention of the World Wide Web in 1993, many people had hopes that there would be a second sphere of the public, which would be in cyberspace. So Gold, one of the more famous people on the social media site, The Well, since the mid-1980s, was experiencing what he calls a virtual community. The idea of the virtual is really interesting because, I mean, in a way, I mean, it is also people. I mean, the people who gather in these virtual communities are, of course, real people. I mean, there's nothing virtual. Just because I'm on Instagram doesn't mean that I'm any less real than I'm here. It is just this idea by the French philosopher Viriot that there is the virtual reality. There is an alternative world out there that is not real. I think this is one of the great misconceptions. But in the early 1990s, many people believed that that would happen. So, as Reingold describes here, there is the virtual world, and in the virtual world, we have virtual communities. We have people, like-minded people, who gather together in something that is comparable to the salon. And many names were given for that sphere. If it would be more public-facing, it was called the blogosphere. So people would write blogs, for example. Blog means web log, that means a diary that you would publish online, or people would just have websites or share images. Mark Andreessen, a young programmer in 1993, introduced the image tag into HTML, and by that turned the World Wide Web that was just starting in that year into a textual and visual medium. So the question is, how much is there a public? And I mean, very quickly, and it took about 2 years, and the publishing industry, the cultural industry, like Walt Disney and Bertelsmann and Random House, and you name them, or the big music labels like Sony, BMG, and so on, they realized that there is something going on that they didn't control, like they would control normally the publishing presses. And so these companies in many countries in the world introduced legislation, and the legislators would look and say, well, there is intellectual property that gets infringed, that gets violated in these online communities. People post pictures of other people's work. People publish other people's music without paying royalties, and so on. And so governments would kind of push back and introduce censorship to protect private property online. And so in the mid-90s, that led to many of the blogs, many of the sites that would invite people to publish their work to be shut down. So the internet service providers, which were telecommunication companies or intermediaries between the telecommunication company and the private people who would run the sites, I mean, same as today, still, they were forced, subpoenaed by the courts in many countries, in the US, in Europe, but also across the globe, to take these sites offline. And people would realize that they would actually not own what they had published. It's not like a book that we have in the library. And I mean, unless the police comes and breaks into our house, which is a really violent thing that in most countries more rarely happens. It's not impossible, of course, that you get a search warrant from the police and people get in trouble for having banned books. That even happens in Europe once in a while. But it is much less likely than that would happen online. And so there is movements to press against that. One movement that I was also personally involved is Freifunk, which means free radio, which is a mesh network of routers. So you could have a router installed that would connect to other routers, and you could share content and have a networked experience across the Freifunk net without ever going to the internet. And of course, that's much harder to censor. There is no Google on freifunk.net. The censorship would have to be introduced in a much more intelligence service-like way here. And of course, I mean, the Freifunk protocol is encrypted, so it's even harder to monitor what people exchange here. On the other side, we have an incredible rise of devices that become increasingly sealed. That's the opposite of Freifunk, where I have my own router, put my own firmware on it, so I fully control what the router does. I mean, I hardly control anything what the iPhone does. It is a shiny box, hermetically sealed. I can't control the operation system without literally breaking the phone. And by this, I really like this quote by Stephen Frank, famous CEO of Panic. He was a developer early on in Apple. This is quote here, that the iPad is not so much a great computer. By that, it's not revolutionary, but it is an ideology. And the ideology is that it is internet per remote control, and it can be used to control what people can do. This is in LaGuardia Airport, where I first saw these iPad devices, iPad-like, another pad, I think it's an Android pad, that force you to order, instead of going to a waiter or to a counter, you order with this pad. In an online interaction, and you can only pay by credit card. So anyone who wouldn't have a credit card means of payment is by definition excluded. So this is the feeling that I have with my iPhone, of course. Since I have a UAE credit card in my Apple account, I can only access the Emirates App Store. And that means that many, many apps that are available in the US or in Europe are not available for me. And I bet that many of you have experienced that already. So that is not the government of the Emirates or the government of the US or whoever forcing some censorship. It is Apple. It is Apple's decision to not publish apps in certain geographical locations for various reasons.
This idea
of an alternative public space of virtual reality was so strong that in 1990, influential people in the Bay Area around San Francisco, Mitch Kapor, John Perry Barlow, John Gilmore, and Steve Wozniak, famous for co-inventing the Apple computer, founded the Electronic Frontier Foundation. So frontier, I mean, is a rather colonial word. I mean, it is like when you push your colonial influence into what you perceive as wilderness. I mean, usually that's a territory where other people live already, like, for example, the frontier in which the American West was settled. So I don't really know what to make of that word. I really don't like it. Nevertheless, people founding it actually, I think, are nice people. John Perry Barlow, a poet and I think a deep thinker and great artist, was a good person. I mean, to use this judgmental term here. So Barlow passed away 2 years ago. John Perry Barlow in 1996 published this declaration of independence of the cyberspace. That tells you already that there is something that can become independent. And what he thinks here, or what he says, is opposing to the communication law that would, in the states, have been passed in 1996, as mentioned, to give influence to intellectual property rights owners, but also regulate other things like online decency, so that you can't just, for example, shout at people with horrible insults, but that the same logic of that you can't insult people applies online, the offline, and so on. And he would write this very strong language manifesto to claim the independence of the cyberspace from the brick and mortar world that was owned by big corporations, the dinosaurs that he saw. But cyberspace, by the way, is an interesting one. I mean, of course, there is cybernetics behind this. There's a concept that in the Second World War was developed by Norbert Wiener, a physicist, to understand control of systems. So, and the word cyberspace was introduced by the science fiction author William Gibson to describe this kind of networked world, the matrix in which so much of his books happen. I can only recommend reading Gibson's books, in particular Neuromancer, the great book. It's really strange to read that it is it's almost 40 years old. And if you look back at the time, I mean, I was a teenager when it was published. I mean, there was no internet anywhere nearby. How much of what was to come Gibson here envisions already, including the cyberspace. So it's this kind of a self-fulfilling prophecy, the cyberspace. And what Barlow demands here in this independence is to claim the cyberspace as public space owned by the people, the netizens, the people who are on the net. There is, of course, I mean, very naive, you would say today, but I think at the time it made really a difference. We really have to discuss that in detail and deconstruct it. In its time, there is a lot of utopian hope in it that things could actually change, that people could be empowered, that the monopoly of opinion making of the great publishers would break, that the idea of the cultural industry, who would turn all the culture into commodities, would finally come to an end and people could kind of own their work by themselves. I think 25 years later, hardly anyone shares this opinion anymore. Maybe there are some niches in the cryptocurrency community, like in the Bitcoin people also, who still believe in what Barlow was writing. And this, I think, is one of the topics of this whole lecture series, that we deconstruct what happened in the internet over the last two decades. It's Twitter's headquarters on Upper Market Street in San Francisco. For me, it was very stunning to get there because that's exactly looking like what John Perry Barlow hates. I mean, clearly, it is a brick and mortar company. It even looks a bit like 19th century. And it is indeed, I mean, very much resembling a classic newspaper publishing house. And it's exactly how Twitter feels. I mean, it is not a technology company when you go there. It doesn't have this nerdy vibe that Google or Facebook have, or so many other Silicon Valley companies. I mean, first of all, it is in the middle of the city of San Francisco, and always was. They just had moved there from their original headquarters in the Tenderloin District, which is still one of the least gentrified and poorest quarters of San Francisco. So Twitter was like an old school newspaper always in the middle of a city. And so this kind of communal publicity vibe that Twitter has is tied to its kind of old school publishing culture that it somehow maintained. And so clearly there is something going on between John Perry Barlow envisioning everything is virtual and Twitter being in this very sturdy brick and mortar building. And of course, I mean, just recently it becomes clear that this vision that everything is free and everything is allowed online can't go on like that. I mean, most countries in the world don't even have a concept of free speech like the United States has. I mean, I come from a country where the idea seems totally obscene that you could just say what you want. I mean, that you can just, for example, say these people should be killed without being punished for that. But in the US, that's a different thing. Many people in the US seem to not see that as a problem. I think that starts now to change. But I mean, coming from a country where the fascist dictatorship was only a generation away when I was born, many of my of the old people around my grandparents' age were horrible Nazis. I mean, still, when I was a child. I mean, I can't find anything good in this idea of free speech absolutism. So this is my private opinion, of course. I can't, of course, tell you what you find good. I think it is really important for every society to negotiate these rules so that they make sense for them. And clearly here, Twitter, I mean, Twitter is a private company, is shutting down the Twitter account of the American president. While probably there is enough reason to do that, like telling all these lies and inciting a riot and so on, that the US president abused his Twitter account for, it is still stunning that a private company can just pull the plug like that. Something is happening here that makes it clear that there has to be a more thorough negotiation between the public and the private. And I think it is, to use Greta Loew's words here again, the point that the less private space you own, the more public space you need. A bit further in the technical sense, looking at the PHP scripting language, and I want to introduce how to build your own themes in WordPress in the next video.